good afternoon and welcome to Talks at GS. I'm honored to be joined today by my friend Richard Armstrong, who's the director of the Guggenheim Museum and Foundation and has been so since 2008. Before joining the Guggenheim, he was a curator at and then director of the Carnegie Museum of Art in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And previously, he was a curator at the Whitney Museum of American Art. Right, well, why don't we take a step back in this beautiful picture of, of the Guggenheim? Maybe just give us an overview of the history of the museum.
You know where it is. It's up at 89th and 5th. What you may not know is it has this waterfront property. So that's the reservoir. And it was a slightly remote part of Manhattan, even as late as the 1950s. And I wanted to show this because this is really the origins of the family's fortune. That's Meyer Guggenheim in the middle, the one with the gray hair. And those are his seven sons around him. The gentleman on the right, third person over, is Solomon Robert Guggenheim. These are Jews who left Switzerland in 1848, along with lots of other Germans, came to Philadelphia, were peddlers, eventually invested in a mine in Leadville, Colorado, which became the biggest silver vein in the world. So they were endlessly well-to-do. Here he is late in life, that's the man in the middle, with that woman to the left who had opened his eyes 20 years prior to the joys of contemporary art. She was herself a painter named Hilla Rebbe, and she'd studied briefly at the Bauhaus. She knew Kandinsky as a personal friend. She came to know Duchamp, Mondrian, lots of other artists, and she's the one who eventually made Guggenheim and his wife basically get rid of their third-rate French collection and amass a very big collection of really first-rate modernism.
How forward pioneering was that at the time?
At the time, it was remarkable because there was a bias in America against Germany based on World War I. And there'd been a previous bias against Germany, even from 1848. She knew Germany well. She was an avant-garde artist. And she's the one who invited Frank Lloyd Wright in 1943 to make the museum, saying, I need a temple for the spirit, because she had very peculiar ideas about art. And her notion was, and this is the part that has validity today, in the company of abstract art, people's behavior can change, in theory, for the better. So that was the motivation for the museum. As I said, she asked Frank Lloyd Wright to do this project. He spent more than 10 years making drawings. And what's interesting is at the beginning, the museum had a very mixed reception by architecture critics and particularly by artists who disliked it intensely, but it was hugely popular from the first day.
With
the public. It's a tough place to work because you've got canted walls, every ramp, there's seven ramps, they all have a different degree of pitch. You know, it's complicated, but I think in the last 15 years at least, the designers and the curators have discovered how to really take advantage of a sequential presentation that really helps you see there's a narrative, it's not being forced down my throat, I'm seeing things in an interesting way, kind of peripherally. So today I would say it's held up tremendously well and is a very dynamic, unusual experience. And we get about 1 million to 1.1 million people annually at this site, and I'd say 50% of them are coming to see the building. Architecture, I think, because of what Frank Lloyd Wright achieved on Fifth Avenue, has also become a huge part of the identity of the institution to its great advantage. That's a great testament to Frank Lloyd Wright.
So you talked a little bit about the mission and how the museum got started. Can you talk about its place today?
Yeah, I really feel like what we offer people is a place for the imagination. Mm-hmm. And honestly, in our society, and also we're a haven for eccentrics, which we accept happily. I think in our society, if those two kinds of pursuits can't be allowed, we're doomed to this, you know, deep homogeneity that's gonna be extremely damaging. So it's just one of those places you can go and have a good time and sort of learn something. But I also wanna say, I've never had the position that going to a museum is about learning anything. In fact, I'm happy
if
people—
say that again?
Yeah, I don't think that's your obligation. You're there in a way to like stimulate your imagination and to get some relief from this constant pressure to be better or more numerous or ahead of other people. You're not there to like get all the data around everything that's happening. You can use the app if you like, you know, that's fine. Or you can read the labels if you want to. That's one easy way to use the place, but honestly, it shouldn't be quantifiable.
You reference culture and the state of culture. Can you talk about art's place in current culture and where you feel it is in the evolution?
Well, ironically, in my time, I think we've watched the visual capacity become privileged even over the oral capacity. So in my day, at early rock and roll, I would have said music was the dominant culture builder, let's say, or the shared information. Now I'd say in today's world, because of handheld devices particularly, visual information is privileged over sound. So in a way, art has risen up to a high capacity of challenge and representation inside society. But we're frequently competing on a daily basis with celebrityhood, you know, the selfie universe. So there's a way that visualization has become extremely dominant, and we have to participate inside that. I do think it helps people become more visually acute, which is to our advantage, but how we can then take our place rightfully inside what's more worthwhile looking at for a longer period of time than what's less worthwhile is a sort of a struggle.
Can you speak about how we decide on what exhibitions to have?
Just like you all, there's a kind of pyramid of responsibility, but actually it's more fun to be in the middle of the pyramid, in my opinion. Unfortunately, I got thrown up towards the top. So what I have to do is look at the people who have ideas and integrity and an ability to be naughty, I would say, because frequently they're saying to me, you're wrong, you're outdated, that rule doesn't matter any longer, you don't understand. These are all the things you're meant to say at a certain age. And I have to look at the person and say, okay, you want to make an exhibition that's going to cost, let's say, $2 million about, you know, Romanian paper clips, which I know nothing about. I go home and read about it and look around, poke, call some friends in Romania and say, is this worth doing? I mean, that's an extreme example. I usually know what it is they're talking about. And then we hold hands and we have to jump off a high dive together, and the trustees have to say, I hope you hit water, because you know, you can put a lot of time and effort into projects and there's a very small audience. That's not saying it's a failure, it's just saying that the per capita investment is higher than we ever anticipated. So my job is to help those people, you know, rise up and eventually kick me out and take over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So listen to this discussion. Some might say this is a pretty elitist conversation.
Yeah.
In an age where issues of poverty and healthcare, why should I come with you to?
Because I would argue, you know, one of our deepest needs, even though it's so hard to recognize this in other people, is the quest for beauty. So your quest for beauty manifests itself in which earrings you're going to put on, which car you bought, how you put the French fries around the hamburger, did you make your bed, what color is the bedroom you're living in, how's he look in the morning, how's she look in the morning, sometimes how do I look in the morning, which is scary, and then it manifests itself in a more and more social way. So in the end, you're not just thinking about beauty, you're thinking about a more complicated concept, which is order. Is there an order in what that person is manifesting in front of me? And that's the job of the artist, is to prove to us that there is order, or that the disorder that he or she's putting forward becomes the new order. And that's where someone like Jackson Pollock is really a key figure. My job then is to say to people like you, who are brought up to be skeptical, there's a new order. Here's what I think it means, and it could mean something to you. Mm-hmm. But you have to give yourself permission to be ill-informed, probably uncomfortable, occasionally worried about how do I fit in with these people, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. But if, as long as you're inquisitive, I think ultimately you'll discover that it's really a tremendously good investment. There's always somebody who has that, you know, branch that can find the water in the ground. And in our case, it's frequently people who work inside museums. Sometimes it is art advisors. Often it's artists themselves. You look at them, you think he or she's fully convinced. They're crazy in a way, but they're committed to what it is they're doing. And that'll go back to that idea of they're redefining beauty. And that is a fundamental quest inside human nature.
Thank you so much. Please join me in thanking Richard.
That was awesome. Thank you so much.